A tribute to my granny. I would have never thought that you would have left so soon. I remember you saying to me, death is all a part of the life cycle and that there shouldn't be a time for sadness, but a time to rejoice. However, right now, I don't know what to think. One of your favorite sayings was never to question God, everything happens for a reason. But Lord, I just want to know why my granny. I am really going to miss the times when I constantly shout for you just to annoy you. And you responding by saying why I don't go and shout for my mother. I am going to miss being able to leave school and say I am going to shout my granny. I am going to miss our time just sitting and laughing together. I am truly thankful that I got to spend time with you. I have so many memories with you. The stories you spoke about growing up, especially walking from Ashton to Rock Hall to take meeting money. And how heavy I was as a baby, leaving your hands and hips stiff. You have always been here for me. You are one of the most loving and caring persons I knew. You always put your loved one before yourself, and that's why I can say I had the best grandmother. Love you always, your granddaughter Inusha.
A tribute and celebration for the life of Lenora Erla Marita Austin. A much loved and cherished aunt dies. Good morning, my name is Annette Leslie. I was very sorry to get the news this month from Aunt Erla's children that Aunt Erla had passed. Last month, I was on holiday in Barbados when I visited her home, and she had been at the front of the house doing a bit of gardening. I live in England, the United Kingdom. But over 68 years ago, I was born in Barbados, St. Peter. My mother, Vera Mel Leslie, left Barbados when I was 2 years old to work and live in England. I remained living in the care and custody of my grandparents, Garfield and Elma Yeoman. At that time in 1953, I lived in a house with 8 other family members. That included Aunt Erla. Although at between 9 and 10 years old, she was only 7 years older than I, she automatically stepped up, took the role of mothering and parenting me alongside my grandparents. We lived in Ashton, in an area now designated as an area of outstanding natural beauty, and we lived in a smallish though extended wooden family house surrounded by acres and acres of fertile fields with every conceivable fruit tree and other trees, sugarcane fields, vegetables and ground provisions and wild herbs for making bush tea. That is where Aunt Erla, with 4 generations of family in the same house, was born and raised. Yes, we were surrounded by coconuts, bananas, mangoes, big avocados, breadfruit, pawpaw, sour salt, guavas, cherries, akis, golden apples, sugar apples, ground provisions, giant cane lilies, dunks trees, monkey dumplings and more. If you could call the name, it grew on our land or in the nearby gully, very close by. In her care role, in her caregiving role of me, every evening, Aunt Erla patiently, gently, and beautifully plaited my hair in readiness for me attending school the next day. She would ensure my school uniform and other clothes were clean and ready for wearing. Aunt Erla was also my protector, shielding me from anyone she felt was being unfair to me. And she and I, we had a great relationship and we chatted easily. She would talk much and clearly when she had something to say. Other times she would be quiet. She didn't talk just for the sake of talking. Aunt Erla was a good listener. She was of a gentle nature. She was sensitive and observant, and she would know and understand you. That's how it was for me. Although I was a fairly well-behaved child, I think I was a bit of a handful at times, as I was always climbing coconut trees, out playing and exploring my local neighbourhood. Fast forward to this year, one of our Ashton neighbours from that period in the 1950s recalled that Aunt Erla fussed over me like a cat with a newborn kitten, she said, like a loving mother. So from a very early age, Aunt Erla showed she would be a natural loving mother. From lovingly caring for first her dolls and then for me. I was pleased when at 17 years old, Aunt Erla married the handsome St. Lucy boy, George Austin, becoming a housewife, a homemaker all her years of marriage. A homemaker, yes, that was her job, her profession. She did not have a career outside her home. Her family were her full-time work and care. 4 children and 8 grandchildren. Many times I've reminisced as an adult, telling others that the unconditional love, the nurture, the acceptance of me for who I am, the kindness and gentleness that Aunt Erla, my grandparents and some others showed to me during my first 9 formative years before I left Barbados helped shape me into the person I am today. Yes, setting my feet on solid foundations, helping to build my self-esteem and belief in myself. I am testimony to that lavish love and care from Aunt Erla and others, and in turn, it has allowed me to invest in others, including doing volunteer and project work to encourage and build up children and others. Over the years, including the last 5 years, Aunt Erla and I love to reminisce over some of the fun times we had when I lived in Barbados, especially on Fridays. That was when workers like her father got paid, so we joined him at a mile and quarter corner shop for refreshments on Friday evening. Aunt Erla, myself and 2 or 3 of her sisters, we ate firm favourites like whippets and corned beef, and drinks included Juicy and Coca-Cola. Then Saturday nights, we would be further up the road near Rose Hill, eating fish cakes, pudding and sauce, laughing and joking, and then frightening ourselves with so many stories about the out man and the heart man. So when returning home after a night out, we could no longer take the shortcut across the fields, but had to take the main roads back home. Sundays, between maybe 3 attendances at church, we skipped out the road to catch the man with a carrot and buy some of the tasty, cold and colourful icy snowball desserts. And Early and I loved to recount these and many other regular socials with longtime friends and neighbours in our community. Indeed, treasured memories that live on in the heart. To quote Aunt Erla's own words to me in recent years, we bloom for a time. Dear Aunt Erla, truly, you bloom for a time. But importantly, I give thanks, I give gratitude that your legacy, the love you showed, will live on. Aunt Erla, rest in peace. Rest in God. Amen. Your niece, Annette. Thank you. Thank you.
nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If you live, you live to the Lord. Christ died and then we. He might be Lord, both of the dead and of the living. We receive the body of our sister Lenora for burial. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may come to those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we gather this morning to give God thanks and praise for the life and witness of our sister Lenora, let us begin this Thanksgiving service by singing the hymn, Angel Voices Ever Singing. we have Eulogy by Nicole Austin Belger, and this will be followed by a solo by Dr. Anthony Carter.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today as we celebrate the life of our dear mother. Lenora Marita Austin was born on the 15th of October, 1946, to Garfield and Alma Yeoman. Mom was christened Lenora, but her dad called her Erla, and that remained with her throughout her lifetime. Maybe only those who knew her would have gone to school with her would have known her as Lenora. She was a quiet person, quiet in nature, quiet in spirit, and she usually kept to herself. It took a whole lot to ruffle Mum. As trials came her way, she always remained faithful, and she would say, "My God is in control." Mom was the fifth of six children, namely Vera, Merlene, Veronica, and Genevieve. She attended All Saints Girls School, and after leaving school, attended sewing classes where she mastered the skill of dressmaking and made our uniforms, dresses for church, casual wear, and even my graduation dress, which I had designed. In 1964, she met our dad, George Austin, who she fell in love with, and soon married in 1965 at 17 years old. Thereafter, moving to Bishop Tenetree in St. Lucie, and later acquiring land at Maynard's housing area, where she lived until she died on April 13, 2022. That union produced four children, Wayne, Gregory, myself, and one other. Sadly, Dad left us on November last year. Mom loved us all, and we loved her even more. That love, too, was shared with all of her eight grandchildren, which she adored and looked forward to seeing and talking to them daily. I surely will miss hearing, "Mommy, what time are we going to my grand-grand Maynard's?" as she was called to differentiate from their other grandmother. A homemaker, that's what Mom was, looking after her family. She was young, and that must have been a mammoth of a task, with no washing machines at that time. But she did it and never once complained. She just did what she had to do. Our parents did their best providing for us and made sure we all progressed in our various careers. Mom was confirmed here at the All Saints Anglican Church, where she attended for many years. The beach and gardening were her hobbies. Sounds quite familiar. I remember her leaving home around 5 a.m. with her friend, Miss Collie Moore, who would meet up with their other beach buddies to socialize at Port St. Charles, enjoy the fruits in season dipped in seawater. I can say Mom had a good life. We made so many memories to share with our children. I recall one of our chats reminiscing on how each of us was as a child, and verbatim, "Gregory was the most troublesome in his younger days." As she spoke of him coming from school, all ruffled, grassed in his hair, pockets torn off, and she had to sew them on daily. She asked him one day, "Why these pockets? Why these always off?" He responded, "Some rastaman had jumped out of the cane field and attacked him, ripping off his pocket. Wayne, quiet in nature, somewhat like Mom, doesn't talk much for talking's sake, unless it's about car racing, shooting, trading, cycling, then that's hours of non-stop talking. We all have a bit of Mom with us. May the angels guide you home to your eternal resting place. May God be with you until we meet again. Love you forever, Mom. I want to say thanks to Dr. Paris Boyce, Dr. Dougling, Dr. Salu and his team, Reverend Lowe, and special thanks to our neighbors, Troy, Django, Sonia, Miss Collie Moore, Anita, and all those for being there for our mother, whether it was just calling or visiting to see how she was doing. To all who sent words of comfort, daily messages, we say thank you. Thanks.
Church, as I was coming in, a friend of mine said to me, we thought it was a different Dr. Carter coming to this funeral. I don't think you know the people in St. Peter that well. Well, just want to say that the Newmans and the Austins were our friends all of our lives. My mom was a nurse, but she was also a seamstress. So Miss Austin and her would get together. My mom would come down many Saturdays and spend the entire day here in St. Peter. Furthermore, I guess some people would know that I have a daughter who was born in St. Peter, who lived in Bentham's afterwards. So don't be surprised. I also was a member of North Club. So call me a honorary St. Peter man. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed will be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, but deliver us from evil. Yes, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Oh.
Remember before you today your servant Lenora. We pray that having opened to her the gates of larger life, you will receive her more and more into your joyful service, that with all who have served you in the past, she may continue to share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. We now have our first Bible reading by Mark Yeoman, and this will be followed by Psalm 46.
A reading from the Good News Version, 2 Timothy 4, verse 1 to 8. In the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead, and because he is coming to rule as king, I solemnly urge you to preach the message, to insist upon proclaiming it, whether the time is right or not, to convince, to reproach, to encourage, as you teach with all patience. The time will come when people will not listen to sound doctrine, but will follow their own desires and will collect themselves more and more teachers who will tell them what they are itching to hear. They will turn away from listening to the truth and give their attention to legends. But you must keep control of yourself in all circumstances. Endure suffering, do the work of a preacher of the good news, and perform your whole duty as a servant of God. As for me, the hour has come for me to be sacrificed. The time is here for me to leave this life. I have done my best in the race. I have run the full distance, and I have kept the faith. And now, there is waiting for me the victory prize of being put right with God, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only me, but to all those who wait with love for him to appear. Here ends the reading.
God is all.
kindly be seated. Our second Bible reading will be done by Hensley Benn, and this will be followed by the hymn, Blessed Assurance.
A blessed good morning to all of you, our children, grandchildren, relatives, friends of the family. I am a friend of the family as well. I have taught the boys, I taught her boys at All Saints when I was a teacher there. So I want to say to you this morning, take heart, smile, dry up those tears and smile. Her husband George used to make all of us smile. Rest assured that she has been taken to be one of the flowers in the master's bouquet. Today's reading is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. This is a very familiar passage read at nearly every funeral. So what I'm going to do, I am going to close my eyes and read it. So I want you to close your ears and listen. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." This is the word of the Lord.
the fullness of time. Kindly be seated. Part of the fourth verse of the fourth chapter, Paul's letter to the Galatians, in the fullness of time. May I speak to you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the fullness of time. This is a phrase from Scripture that comes to mind as we remember our sister here departed. Our sister had a full life. And even as we gathered here this morning with sadness, that sadness is shot through with a deep serenity and a great gratitude for life. When we say before God that we are thankful to have known and loved someone like our sister here departed, we are in fact thanking God for revealing something of himself yet again in human form. It was only in Jesus Christ that we saw the glory and goodness of God fully shining in a human face. And yet, it's also true that in the goodness of every human being, there's another, if different, revelation of God. Incomplete, flawed, but nevertheless a mirror of his love. Why, as I said, is our morning mingled with such quiet gratitude today? The answer, my friends, is because we have been in the presence of someone who helps us to glimpse God. As St. Paul puts it, not I that live, but Christ that lives in me. And we are here in this life to echo the life of Christ, to grow in wisdom, to reach out like him in healing to the wounded of the world, to love children, to have compassion and forgiveness on the weak and suffering, and we can go on and on. But these facts of Christ himself are alive for us today because we glimpse them in the struggling life and love of our sister Lenora. Struggling because, like all of us, she was imperfect, yet a struggling love because through a long life, she learned from God to let go of herself and to live for others. And now she has let go finally. Our consolation today then comes from gratitude for our sister, for God in her, for Christ glimpsed through her. But all real consolation comes in the faith that looks through death, in the hope that gathers us here, the hope that as our sister shared in Christ's way of life and now shares his death, so she will also belong with Christ in her new life. We cannot understand that hope or even fathom it. And yet, we can have it. We cannot always explain that faith. And yet, it makes sense for our hearts this day. My friends and Christ, we cannot put words on that love. We cannot fully explain the love of God. And yet, when we have seen it in a good person's life and death, we too are able to recognize it and to say a deeper and more grateful yes to Almighty God. I am sure that you present here this morning have seen a good life in our sister Lenora. No two people are alike. And it's this very uniqueness which makes us love, not only by our fellow men, but especially by God. That wonderful phrase of our Lord Jesus Christ in the gospel about the hairs on our head being numbered by our Heavenly Father, and not even one sparrow can fall to the ground without God knowing about it, is surely proof of the value which God puts on every human life. We are here for a purpose, all of us, a divine purpose, and the hand of God has been laid on us all. The hand of God was laid on our sister, and never more than during her last days. The dignity with which she faced death is very much the fruit, if not the proof, of the dignity and unrighteousness showed throughout her life. The lesson of old age then is that of endurance of faith. And we must be aware that throughout our lives, there are the valleys and the hills, the good times and the bad times, the successes and the failures, the joys and the sorrows. We have a very short span of life given to us by God. And those who live the longest become deeply aware that this time is not given so much for our enjoyment, but rather to work in His kingdom and work out our own salvation. Not one of us is even given sufficient time to sink our roots too deeply into this world. With advancing age, we learn that we have not here a lasting kingdom, but wait for one that is to come. No one can work out his or her own salvation alone. We need examples all around us. We need examples to point out a better way, a sure road, a safer path. Our sister would have been a wonderful example of those old world values. Yes, my friends, in our space age and atomic age, many of us are lost and confused. Science seems to have turned not only our physical world, but also our spiritual world upside down. And this can be seen all around us day by day. The solid rock of common sense, as well as the practice of Christian virtues, must not be lost sight of in our modern world. Honesty, integrity, and goodness are not meant with so often today, and more's the pity. Our sister lived as a lady and died as one. I watched her in her last couple hours of death, and I said, that's a peaceful woman. The way she lived is the way she went. Above all then, my friends, she showed her great appreciation of the services and devoted attention of those people with whom she came into contact with on a daily basis. The Christian who has suffered long and who has died in peace with dignity has lived the gospel. This service this morning for our sister Lenora is a celebration of the power of the grace of God and a dramatic message to all of how to be truly human, of how to rise to the challenge of illness and difficulties that confront us day after day in the ways that are enriching and life-giving. And above all, a proclamation that the human being's real life is with God in eternal happiness. And so, our prayer this day is that she now enjoys that continuing peace and happiness for which she pined throughout her life here on earth. And that God has now taken her into his safe keeping. My friends, in the fullness of time, all of this will take place. Amen. Let me take this opportunity on behalf of the entire parish family here of All Saints to extend our deepest condolences to the family and friends of our dear sister Lenora. She was one of our ardent members here at All Saints every Sunday and every Tuesday morning at our 10 o'clock service. But because of the COVID situation, she was unable to attend. And she even mentioned that to me in her last hour of death. She said, "I could not make it out because of the COVID situation." And that was just about an hour or two before she passed away. Her daughter was there and she heard when she said that. And so she is one of the pillars of this church who have said goodbye. But she has left a legacy. And that is for all of us remaining here to use her as a springboard to continue life on this earthly pilgrimage. May she continue to rest in peace and to rise in glory. I also want to acknowledge the presence of the Honorable Minister Colin Jordan, who shared the same sentiments with me as well. Rest eternal, grant unto her, O Lord, let light perpetual shine upon her. May she continue to rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen. Let us all stand and reaffirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed found in your booklet. I believe in God, for the prayers of the church. For our sister Lenora, let us pray to the Lord Christ, who said, "I am resurrection and I am life." Lord, you console Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Lenora and dry the tears of those who weep. Hear us, Lord. You went at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. Hear us, Lord. You raised the dead to life. Raise our sister Lenora to eternal life. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven. Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints. Yes, she was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Yes, comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Please stand for the commendation. you sing the hymns, "The King of Love My Shepherd Is, and Come We That Love the Lord." During these hymns, a collection be taken, which be used for the continual work here, especially in our graveyard.
Thank you. time to live. However, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn from hell? But to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins. Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins. And at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. A sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister Lenora Marita. Ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Lenora Marita and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants, who having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. All this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Unto God's most gracious mercy and protection we commit her. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious unto her.
Thank you. Thank you. the promises of God. I am standing on the promises of God. Standing, I am standing on the promises of God.
Any other family members, please come forward.
Thank you, ma'am.
Rifle and Pistol Association. You know anybody from Rifle and Pistol?
No.
Anybody coming forward?
I'll just go and find them. Just ask somebody. Let's
get beyond
it.
Well, she's from Rifle and Pistol.
I don't know
what
that was. Any other family members behind the staff?
Our family members are over there.
I'm sure they missed that for
grandchildren, please.
Let us pray. O Lord, support us all the day along this troublous life. Do the days lengthen and the evening comes. The fever of life is over and our work is ended. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant unto your servant Lenora a holy rest and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Go in peace. I continue to serve the Lord.